The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Philippi, and it's recorded in the third chapter of Philippians, the 13th and 14th verse, where he says, "One thing I do is forgetting those things that are behind, I press on." This is most certainly an encouragement to Paul himself, but I believe an encouragement to the church at Philippi as well, because often this is what is needed. You know, in our journey, sometimes we grow stagnant. Sometimes we don't seem to move in God as we once did. Well, Moments of Life is an instrument in the hands of God to edify you and strengthen you and encourage you. I look forward to sharing with you every single week as we dive into the Word of God together and move into new revelation, new understanding, new knowledge that's going to increase your application of the Word of God and bring greater fruitfulness into your journey. We're going to go together as we dive into the Word moment by moment, for these moments of life are just for you. It's another great day in the kingdom, simply because you are alive and you are living and you are enjoying the new mercies of God. That's cause to celebrate. That's cause to give God honor and praise, because he's given me another opportunity to be able to serve him, another opportunity to share the love of Jesus with so many people, a great opportunity day in and day out to really bring change and impact into the world that we are living in. So I am rejoicing in the fact that we get a chance to redeem time to get again together, because your life means so much to me, more than you could ever imagine. And my whole desire is for all of us to get into a greater place in God. Moments of Life is providing that for us. And so I pray that when you're away, that you're following these series, that you're letting other people know about them, sitting down with others and sharing them, breaking bread together, learning and growing, ascending into the greater things of God. That's my hope for you. And that's what Moments of Life is affording to all of us when we really plug in and take hold of the mind of Christ in new and more awesome ways. What I want to do in this moment is to continue, as I seek to always do, and that's to enhance your awareness of the friend that we really truly have in Jesus. I want to say this to you, is that he didn't save you so that he would have someone to be submitted to him. That's a part of the journey that we're on, but he saved you in order that you would be his friend. He didn't save you so that you would become one that knows the Bible from Genesis to Revelations. And all of that is very important, and you should know the Bible from Genesis to Revelations. But many people stop there as that being the real reason that they're saved. But no, he did it in order that he could befriend you and the two of you could walk through your life together, a life that he's already gone ahead and prepared for you and put in place for you and has done everything so that you would not just be successful, but that you would be significant as well. Jesus wanting us to befriend him is really a simple concept, but it's one that many people in the body never really get into. And I believe that that explains why the body of Christ looks the way it does. I believe it explains the reason why the world that we're in looks the way that it's in. It's simply because most of the goal and the aim of the people of God is not really to know Jesus as Lord, to know him as friend, to know him as confidant, to be able to walk with him and connect with him in ways that are exceedingly and abundantly above that which we could ask and or think. But that should be our goal. That should be our aim. But often, because of what church and the church setting does to us, there are forms that make us feel like we're doing the things that Jesus would have us to do. And in these forms, while we are doing things, we believe that because I'm doing them, you should be responding to me, Jesus. I want you to turn to Luke, the 7th chapter, and I'm going to show you where that was one of the problems with the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious people of Jesus's day. They believed that their forms were enough to move Jesus. And I just want to enlighten us on some things to help us in this, so that in all we're getting, we get understanding, because it's all about how can we connect better with Jesus. Look again at Luke, the 7th chapter, and we're going to dive into the 31st and the 32nd verse. The 31st verse of Luke 7 says, "So to what shall I compare the men of this generation. This is Jesus speaking. He says, so what shall I compare the men of this generation? And what are they like? Verse 32 goes on to say, they're like little children sitting in the marketplace, calling the one another and saying, we piped to you, meaning we played wedding with you and you did not dance. We sang dirges and wailed, meaning we played funerals and you did not weep. These are the things that we did for you. But here's the thing that I want you to understand in present day. Jesus doesn't respond to forms. And there are many people who are doing things in religiosity, trying to get Jesus to respond to the particular form, to the particular thing that they put in place, to the particular thing that they do, only to find out that Jesus doesn't respond to forms. What does Jesus respond to then, Apostle? Jesus responds to intimacy. He responds to those who delight in him, those who take satisfaction in him. He delights in those who pleasure in him. Those are the people that Jesus responds to. Hear me this, my friend. Jesus is the only one who can be your everything. And he wants to move beyond forms. He wants to move beyond just going to church, just praying, just fasting, just being a part of a ministry, just moving in your spiritual gifts. No, he wants to be your everything. See, Jesus is the one who can fulfill every single role in your life. And he can bring change into every aspect of your heart. Because he's wired like this. He carries every single thing that you need. Often we, in our relationship with Jesus, it mirrors our relationship with people. And that's one thing we have to divest of, is that this relationship with Jesus is far different, more valuable, more important. It's more sensitive. It's more meaningful. And the dynamics of it are far different than our worldly relationships, which we've grown up in. In our worldly relationships, they're conditioned by a who, by a what, by a when, by a where, by a how. They're according to waiting for the perfect time or the perfect place to do anything or the perfect time to get into that relationship. But here's the key with Jesus. He's already here. He's already here just waiting for you and I to reach out to him and to grasp him and take hold of him, take hold of him and all of his realness and all of his true love so that you can experience, so that I can experience what true love is really like. Can you imagine what your relationship would be like in God if from the beginning you knew it was all about intimacy? You knew it was all about relationship with him. He wants to meet you exactly where you are. So how do I maximize that? How do I get into that place? I think there's three things that you can do that will help you to do that. And I want you to jot those things down. Number one is to choose love over fear, because fear is a powerful thing and it makes you feel unaccepted. It makes you feel ridiculed, makes you feel like you're going to be ridiculed. Fear makes you feel as though you deserve to be abandoned or you're going to be abandoned. You're going to have pain. You're going to have rejection. These are the things that fear does. And many people never enter into intimacy with Jesus because they believe that he's going to abandon them. He's going to be painful in the relationship. It's going to be a period of rejection or a season of rejection or a life of rejection. And none of these things are accurate. Those are lies that are straight out of the pit of hell. You have to declare that you will not entertain those feelings. You have to declare that you will not entertain or listen to those type words that try to raise up in your soul. In 2 Timothy, the second chapter in the 7th verse, I want you to note that. He says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. And so we have to choose love over fear. Second thing that I believe that all of us have to do to begin to move into deeper intimacy with Jesus is we have to decide whose we are. We have to choose to accept that he wants your friendship. I want you to turn to John, the 15th chapter and the 15th verse. You and I have to choose that we want to be in relationship with him because he's already chosen to be in relationship with us. John, the 15th chapter and the 15th verse says this, I do not call you servants any longer, for the servant doesn't know what his master is doing or what he's working out. But I've called you my friends. Why? Because I've made known to you everything I've heard from my Father. I have revealed to you everything that I have learned from him. So number one thing we have to do is we have to choose love over fear. Number two, we have to choose and understand who we really are. And then thirdly, we have to open our heart to a love that's like no other love. I'm telling you, woman of God, it's time for you, hear me, sons of God, it's time for you to go all in serving the Lord. You will not know him at a deeper place unless you dive in deeper, unless you get into a place where you're just totally in over your head with him. But even when you feel like you're over your head, you're never over your head. Even when you feel like you're in a place that's not going to work out in him because it's new and fresh and different, you're never really in that place because in all of that, he's right there with you. I'm telling you, it's time now to dig into his word, to pray like you've never prayed before, and even ask him to reveal himself to you like he's never, ever revealed himself to you. I want you to push past you. I want you to push past what you think people think about you. I want you to push past your perceptions. I want you to push past what you saw mom do in God and what you saw dad do in God. I want you to push past your preacher, your apostle, your prophet. I want you to push past those people that you believe in ministry are people who are really moving and getting things done, not in competition with them, but be willing to push past all of that. And most importantly, be willing to let him know that above all things, above all people, above all places, Jesus, I just want an authentic, divine relationship with you far beyond anything I've ever had. And then here's your discipline. Here's the key. Then wait for it. Wait for it to happen. Give it time to happen. Get in the presence of God and sit there and let it happen. It may take some days. It may take some weeks. But when you're crying out to God like this and you're turning your heart in these type of postures toward God, just wait for it. Because I'm telling you, it will happen. It will come to pass. In John, the 4th chapter and the 10th verse, it says of Jesus that he answered her. And he said this to the woman at the well in John 4:10. If you had only known and recognize God's gift and who this is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Jesus wants you to have living water. It's time to move beyond any stale place, any mundane place, any status quo place, any place where the brook or the river or the lake or the ocean that you were once in is dried up. It's time to move beyond even church. It's time to move beyond church roles. It's time to move beyond church forms because you're bigger than that. And there's a Jesus who wants to embrace you in new and phenomenal ways. So Lord, we pray today that the eyes of our understanding, that our awareness, that our desire and our thirst for you begin to be enlarged. We pray, God, because there are places that have dried up in our lives and we need you at a new level. You're promising us promises. You're anointing us with greater anointings. You're manifesting greater level of giftings in us, God. But Lord, we know there's so much more. And that's what we want is the more of you, not what you bring. We just want you. So let it be done and let it be so. In Jesus' name, I love you with the love of the Lord. Look forward to seeing you the next time. Going to share something with you that I believe is going to revolutionize your life and get you into a better and more awesome place in him. Take care. This has been your moment of life. Apostle Terrell, I'm out. Peace.